All right, so we'll pick up here with our lecture, Kingdom, Israel, and the Church. Obviously, going through the parables, you know that a lot of them have to do with the kingdom. So this is just a natural kind of transition here into this topic. So let's jump in here. All right. So I don't know why this isn't showing up completely. Again, PowerPoint never agrees with me. But so Ladd says, one of the most difficult questions in the study of the kingdom of God is its relationship to the church. That is the kingdom of God in any sense of the word to be identified with the church? Okay, so that will raise our first question. How does the church relate to the kingdom? What do you think? Anybody have any suggestions? Okay, what does Roman Catholicism say? Anybody? Okay, so the church is the kingdom. Also, some forms of Augustinianism say that. That the church is the kingdom. Okay? What about classic dispensationalism? Nobody? All right, so the kingdom is postponed due to Israel's rejection, and the church is now in a parenthesis. Okay, so the Jewish kingdom comes suddenly at the end of the age. So where the Roman Catholic Church would say that the church is the kingdom, all right, classic dispensationalism sees no connection, right? Complete discontinuity between the two. The kingdom is something reserved for the future. It was promised to Israel. They rejected it, so now it's put on hold, and it'll come back later. Okay, and so now we're in this kind of parenthesis in God's plan. Okay, so the church is not related at all to the kingdom. Okay, well, Ladd writes, in biblical idiom, the kingdom is not identified with its subjects. They are the people of God's rule who enter it, live under it, and are governed by it. The church is the community of the kingdom, but never the kingdom itself. Okay, so what is Ladd doing? He's trying to put kind of a media position between two polar opposites, right? Where one says not at all, one says entirely. Ladd says that the church is the community of the kingdom, but never the kingdom itself. Jesus' disciples belong to the kingdom as the kingdom belongs to them, but they are not the kingdom. The kingdom is the rule of God. The church is the society of men. Okay, so as we think about how the church and the kingdom relates, this is really good language to use. And Ladd is a good source to go on this. I mean, Ladd is really one of the reasons that classic dispensationalism did a step back and said, okay, maybe we need to rethink how we view the kingdom and the church. All right, so they're not the same. They're not entirely different. There is a relationship there. And so how does this work itself out? Well, we know that the kingdom proclamation calls the church into existence. The dynamic rule of God present in the mission of Jesus challenged men to response, bringing them into a new fellowship. And the word new for me is very problematic, but I'll use it for right now. I think we need to think of it more in terms of a new experience of God, not in a way that replaces the old experience, okay? But another in addition to what Israel had experienced, okay? And so that's what we think about in Jesus' ministry. You think about in Luke 4:18. Does someone want to read that quickly? Maybe you haven't memorized. What does Jesus say? Luke 4:18.
The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to tell the poor the good news, He has sent me to announce release to the prisoners. And sight to the blind, to set the wounded victims free, to announce the year of God's special favor.
Okay, so this new experience, but not new. Okay, maybe a renewed experience, if we want to think about it in those terms. So the presence of the kingdom meant the fulfillment of the Old Testament messianic hope promised to Israel. Okay, so you see that the kingdom is the concept and idea, some people say, is established in Genesis 1. Okay? And then it's this thread that moves through Scripture. And then you get to Jesus, and then Jesus begins to bring this thing to life. And so Ladd concludes this. I think I have it on here, if it shows up for me. Yep. So he says, when the nation Israel as a whole rejected the offer, okay, so Jesus brings the kingdom, promised in the Old Testament, when they reject the offer, those who accepted it were constituted the new people of God, the sons of the kingdom, the true Israel, the incipient church. Do you see anything that's wrong with this statement? Or are you okay with it? Okay, yeah, yep. So here's Ladd's framework. So Ladd is helpful when we think about the kingdom, but for someone who's anti-replacement theology like I am, he only goes so far for me. Okay, and so I would argue that the presence of the kingdom meant, yes, the fulfillment of the Old Testament messianic hope promised to Israel, but this did not create a new people. Okay, it did not create a new people, but rather it ushered in the eschatological hope of the inclusion of the nations, which Paul calls the commonwealth of Israel. So you think about Ephesians 2:12. And this to me is how Paul makes sense of Israel and the nations. I don't think that Paul would make sense of Israel and the church, and I'll talk about that in a minute, but how Paul makes sense of Israel and the nations. And he doesn't consider them distinct entities, but he also doesn't say one replaces the other. He puts them under this umbrella of what is now the commonwealth of Israel in Christ. Not that they're all Israel, okay, but they're all under the commonwealth of Israel. Nope. There is unity in diversity. Okay, so he says in Ephesians, which is troubling, there's one new man, but then he maintains a distinction by saying, now both of you. Okay, so there's this interesting interplay in Paul's mind for how God's people are constituted, seeing a unity within a diversity. And those are maintained. And so there's this tension. And so maybe that's a way you want to think about it, but I'm sure we'll do something in that Ephesians passage later in the semester. So I just stole someone's thunder, unless I'll be teaching it I did last semester. All right, so the question, though that's often raised is, didn't Israel reject the kingdom? Yep, they did. On some level, they did. Okay, but there were also those who accepted the kingdom. Who within Israel accepted the kingdom in Jesus' ministry? The disciples who became the apostles. Are they Israel? Yeah. So how can we say that Israel did not accept the kingdom? They did. And so we have the eschatological act of messianic deliverance, the resurrection, which would have directed, which I think the apostles, to certain prophecies which then now spoke of the nation's inclusion. Okay, so yes, part of Israel has rejected. There's a part that has accepted the kingdom. And now, as a result of eschatological promise and fulfillment taking place, now the nations begin to come in. So the kingdom proclamation means Gentile inclusion, which later is understood as the church. But this is not at the expense of Israel's continued existence by means of a faithful remnant. Okay, so you have Israel and the church. Okay, one does not replace the other. They, because of eschatological promise, are now seen as God's people, All right, but there's a distinction that still remains on some level. So that's a tension that hopefully maybe you're feeling, and hopefully we'll be able to address as the class continues to go. All right, so we have the our first point was the church, or the kingdom proclamation calls the church into existence. Second, the church preaches the kingdom. The church preaches the kingdom. It is the church's mission to witness to the kingdom. The church cannot build the kingdom or become the kingdom, but the church witnesses to the kingdom, to God's redeeming acts in Christ, both past and future. So that's one of our roles as kingdom people, as if we want to see the kingdom back in Genesis 1, as what Adam and Eve were created to do, be kingdom people. Okay, and so now we pick up that as redeemed people. Well, how is this accomplished? And I would argue that Jews continue to worship and proclaim Jesus as Messiah as Jews. And for them, that's going to mean a certain ascribed identity. And then for Gentiles, we will worship and proclaim Jesus as Lord as Gentiles. And how do we do that? We refrain from idolatry. Our problem from Scripture seems to be that the Gentile problem is idolatry. And so that's one way that we preach the kingdom. And so again, you have this unity in diversity. God's people, Jew and Gentile, both preach the kingdom, but it may look different. So you think about Galatians. Why does Paul say that there are two gospels? One to the circumcised and the other to the uncircumcised. You have a proclamation of the kingdom with different implications. One gospel, different implications. So these are things to hold in tension. Hopefully we'll be able to talk about them more as the semester goes on. So the church preaches the kingdom, first to Israel, then to the nations. I wonder why this pattern is in place. And you notice, Paul doesn't drop this pattern. This is Paul's pattern. And if we believe that the Gospels were written after Paul, this is the pattern that the Gospel writers ascribe to Jesus. And more so to Jesus, to just the Jew. And then also the authority of the keys. So what kind of authority is spoken here? Obviously, this is a fairly debated point, so I'm not going to pretend to try to hit at all different levels, but I'll just say a few things. So is this authority to make decisions for the conduct of the church over which Peter exercised supervision? So is this kind of an authoritarian type keys that were handed? Or is the authority entrusted to Peter grounded upon revelation? That is, spiritual knowledge which he shared with the 12. So Ladd says, the keys of the kingdom are therefore the spiritual insight which will enable Peter to lead others in through the door of revelation through which he has passed himself. And so you have this picture of the disciples going out. And some people accept their message, and some people reject their message. And so it's this idea of them communicating this new revelation of God. Okay? And what Ladd wants to call them then is the custodians of the kingdom. He says their ministry had the actual result either of opening the doors of the kingdom to men or of shutting it to those who spurned their message. Okay, so this, you see that in Acts, begins to include the nations. It begins with the Jewish people returning, and those sermons in Acts where thousands of people accept Jesus as Messiah, those people are Jewish people. So it begins with a Jewish restoration, and then the nations begin to come in along with that. Next, the church demonstrates kingdom life. The disciples of Jesus not only proclaimed the good news about the presence of the kingdom, they were also instruments of the kingdom, in that the works of the kingdom were performed through them as though Jesus himself. Okay, and so we receive the Holy Spirit. We demonstrate kingdom life in the little things we do, in the big things we do. Okay, but what it means to be guided by the Holy Spirit, to live a certain way, is demonstrating what it means to be kingdom people, what we were created to do, how we were created to operate. So what difference then does it make if the kingdom is equated with the church? Okay, so what is wrong with Roman Catholicism if we say that the kingdom is the church? Okay. So you almost have this overtake, right? If the church is the kingdom, then what governs the church on some level? Right? So you have the church becomes politicized, you have Christendom, and the kingdom will spread gradually until the church attains world dominance. Okay. But we would say that's problematic. I guess if you're a postmillennial, if you're into postmillennialism, you might be okay with that. So if you are and you're not laughing, maybe you're a postmillennialist. Or I guess a preterist, too. You could be happy with this. All right, so Ladd says, while the church is not the kingdom, they are inseparable. There can be no kingdom without a church, those who have acknowledged God's rule, and there can be no church without God's kingdom. But they remain two distinguishable concepts, the rule of God and the fellowship of men. So then further and more importantly, the way we frame this question often overlooks the continued significance of Israel. So that's how I might also answer this question. Even just the way we think about how these two work. You know, our question, well, how does the kingdom and the church relate? And oftentimes it's at the expense of Israel. Okay. So that moves us into Israel and the church. So, question, did Jesus intend to found a church? All right, Matt says, yep. Okay. Anybody disagree? EJ wants to agree or disagree, but he's holding his tongue like a smart man. All right. So many scholars have denied that Jesus had any idea of the creation of a church. Okay, so it is not unheard of if somebody rose their hand and raised their hand and said, Matt, I disagree with you. Jesus had no concept of this. Okay, that would not be out of line on some level. So you have Alfred Loisy. Jesus foretold the kingdom of God, but it was the church that came. Okay, so Jesus comes and he preaches this message of the kingdom, but the church comes instead. Okay, that's one. Okay, Jesus' followers misunderstood him. What did the disciples say in Acts 1:6? You guys need to memorize the Bible. Just kidding.
So when the apostles came together, they put this question to Jesus. Master, they said, is this the time when you are going to restore the kingdom to Israel?
Okay. Is it possible that the disciples misunderstood him? Okay. Classic dispensationalism. The church is plan B. Okay. So, Moody has roots in dispensationalism. So at one time, they would have been perfectly fine with this. And there may be one guy in Chicago who would still be perfectly fine with this. So, the argument is this. Jesus offered Israel the early millennial Davidic kingdom, but when they rejected it, he introduced a new purpose to form the church. Okay, so Jesus' goal was to come and to say, okay, I have the kingdom, you want it? And Israel says, nope, we don't. And so Jesus turns to plan B. In this view, there's no continuity again between Israel and the church, because the kingdom is for Israel, it's not for the church. So then the kingdom is put on hold. Jesus turns to plan B, the nations, develops the church, and then the kingdom comes later.
They don't necessarily all, I mean, you wouldn't necessarily have to say it was plan B though, right? I mean, that's kind of, I mean, obviously you got to frame it how you want to, but if, in a sense, you could say that it was always an intention. I'm not arguing because I really don't.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, couldn't you say that automatically your intention was that you knew that was going to happen? Like, you had to offer. If you don't make the offer, it's not a real offer.
Well, I mean, yeah, I mean, if we pull up into the theological categories, as far as who is Jesus and how do we understand him, then obviously, but this was really the tension that classic dispensationalism had and why they revised.
Okay.
Because this was an issue, because there was definitely this view of...
It was like the plan B makes it... Yep. Brings it down to level.
Yep, and then Lad is the one who comes in and says, you know, we need to rethink some of this stuff. So Lad writes, if Jesus' mission was, as we contend, that of inaugurating a time of fulfillment in advance of an eschatological consummation, and if in a real sense the kingdom of God and his mission invaded history, even though in an utterly unexpected form, then it follows that those who received the proclamation of the kingdom were viewed not only as the people who would inherit the eschatological kingdom, but as the people of the kingdom in the present, and therefore in some sense of the word, a church. Okay, so in some sense, the church, God's people, presently constituted what it meant to be kingdom people. So now there's this tension of the already, not yet, which you guys talked about, right? Okay. All right. So then this raises the question for me. The whole discussion of Israel and the church raises the question of the term ecclesia. Okay, so we talk about... What is the difference between Israel and the church? Is there a difference? How did Jesus view the difference? How did Paul view the difference? And recently, there's been quite a bit of scholarship coming out saying maybe we are asking the wrong questions here on some level. And so I think about the word ecclesia. Rarely used in the synoptics, but when it is, what does it mean? Okay, so gathering assembly, so the accuracy of the gospel reporting. So somebody read Matthew 16:18. Okay, so on this rock, I will build my what? Church. Okay, so on this rock, I will build my ecclesia. Question is, did Jesus mean church? Or let's say, did Matthew mean church? Or did Matthew mean ecclesia? Okay, and so this is a major question. When the other gospel writers use this term, do they mean what we think of as church? Or ecclesia, which isn't the church as we think it to be, when Paul uses this term. Okay, so the saying, and this is Ladd, the saying does not speak of the creation of an organization or institution, nor is it to be interpreted in terms of the distinctively Christian ecclesia as the body and bride of Christ, but in terms of the Old Testament concept of Israel as the people of God. The idea of building a people, which is the Old Testament idea here. Furthermore, ecclesia, as a biblical term, probably had the sense of the assembly of God's people, as Kahal did in the Old Testament. So as Matt said, the idea here is assembly or gathering. Okay, but then this still raises the question, what does that mean? What would that mean in a first century context for somebody to hear that? Probably wouldn't have meant church. Okay, so if it wouldn't have meant church, Jesus does not establish a separate or closed fellowship from the synagogue. According to Matthew, Jesus does not institute a new way of worship. He does not institute a new cult, a new organization. Rather, his preaching and teaching remained within the total context of Israel's faith and practice. Okay, Jesus' announcement of his purpose to build his ecclesia suggests that the fellowship established by Jesus stands in direct continuity with Old Testament Israel. The distinctive element is that the ecclesia is in a particular way the ecclesia of Jesus. My ecclesia. Okay, so we'll talk a little bit about what is ecclesia then, and how should it be understood. But this idea of these voluntary associations that could be developed within the broader synagogue. Okay, and it depend on, as a Jewish person, your kind of way of life. So you had Pharisaic associations, you had Essenes that could have been viewed as a form of an association, and then you have this apostolic association within the synagogue of now what Jesus calls, or Matthew calls, my ecclesia. So that is, the true Israel now finds its specific identity in its relationship to Jesus. So Israel as a nation rejected the messianic salvation proclaimed by Jesus, but many accepted it. Jesus sees his disciples as the renewed Israel. Okay, and so they are going to develop then this movement, but it's within this synagogue movement. Okay, so this is where Anders Rudson is really helpful. Okay, Anders Rudson does a lot of work on ecclesia, and he's a trustworthy guy, so don't think that he is just anybody. But if you want to check out his books, I have most of them checked out. So you can't have them right now. All right, so, and he asks this, the question of terminology. So the discussion of Israel and the church, is it even valid? If, when they use the term ecclesia, they wouldn't have associated it with what we associate it with. Okay, so what is meant by ecclesia? I'm just going to read through some of what Rudson says. He says, what I want to stress here, and speaking of Matthew, so we looked at the Matthew passage, Matthew 16, 18. What I want to stress here is that Matthew's use of ecclesia, 16, 18, 18, 17, cannot be referred to in order to claim that the church has now come into being as if the church were something other than a synagogue. That would be impossible in the first century. The term ecclesia was used within the synagogue movement. Ecclesia was one of the many synagogue terms in the first century, but our English word church presupposes that the institution it designates is something other than the synagogue. Church is a term, therefore, that should be avoided altogether in first century context, since it misleads us to interpret the text anachronistically as something removed from a Jewish context. And so oftentimes, when we use the word church, and I'm not saying we shouldn't use the word church, okay? Don't hear that, all right? But we need to think about what he's going to say next is that the words we use control the way we think. And if, when we use the word church, when we hear in Matthew's gospel, when Matthew says that Jesus says, on this rock, I will build my church. If we have this concept of, okay, so church means primarily Gentile, it means primarily this, that's dangerous. Okay, we have to think through how these New Testament authors would have understood this and how they would have used it. Okay, so the words we use control the way we think. So then when Paul uses ecclesia, should we assume that people thought of this institution in the same way as we do today when we hear the word church? Something non-Jewish? Okay. Rather, ecclesia could be a referent to a democratic-like Greek or Roman institution, a Jewish public institution, or a Jewish voluntary association. And so what Paul's probably doing is he's bringing his people under the broader synagogue movement within these apostolic associations, And think about the tension as you read Paul's letters that there would be between now the nations coming into these associations. Right? And so down the road, some kind of a split does happen. And then now maybe we need to talk more fully about, okay, now the church. All right, but this idea of the church as this group of people that's separate from Israel could be a dangerous way to think about how Paul understood when he used these terms. So Paul's use of ecclesia indicates that as the apostle to the nations, he is inviting non-Jews to participate in specific Jewish institutional settings, where they may share with the Jews the experience of living with the risen, of living in Christ. They have been invited to join a specific group of Jews, not to replace the Jews, as if living in Christ for non-Jews necessitated a life in isolation from the synagogue. And so I just think of Galatians, okay, the book that I'm working in. And Galatians 1:2, Paul says he's writing to the ecclesias of Galatia. Okay, so he's writing to these people who are still within the synagogue movement. Later he says, I persecuted the ecclesia of God. Okay, who's he persecuting? Oftentimes we think Paul's a persecutor of the church. He was a persecutor of Christ followers, but probably Christ followers within the synagogue. Also, the term Israel of God. Would Paul associate a Jewish term onto his Gentile people? I don't think so. Right? Because there are these two people, God's people, and we're coming together and trying to figure out how this is going to work. As you read Paul, this is a tension. This is a major tension. This is what... What's her name now? Kathy Arnsberger says that Paul is a bicultural mediator. All right, and so trying to think about this idea of Israel and the church, is that even how we should be thinking? Because if you ask Paul, what's your view on Israel and the church? He might say, the church? What do you mean? So, the whole discussion of the church replacing Israel is a post-first century construction. For Paul and the gospel writers, there was no church to replace Israel with. Rather, the nations were joining what Paul calls the commonwealth of Israel. Now, if you want to disagree with me, you can read Michael Byrd. Because he would. So, this is not, don't hear me say that, this is the only view out there that is a possible view. Okay, there are other people, so if you're feeling tension with this, study it out and focus it. Focus on it.
It does make sense though when they go into Solomon's porch in the temple and where they meet, they're meeting in the temple, right? They're
mm-hmm.
Like it's still identifying directly with that association. Right?
Yep. So then the question is, if Jesus did not, in a way, come to form a church, not because he was anti-church like the classic dispensationalist, but just because for Jesus that wouldn't be the idea, right? He comes to build his ecclesia, Jews and non-Jews within these associations within the broader synagogue movement. So then the question is, how does Jesus' ministry relate to the Jews? Okay. So Jesus is ushering in the kingdom not to start something new. Right? He's ushering in the kingdom because this was a promise made to Israel. Okay, and then you see in his ministry, it's really directed toward Israel. So it's important to keep in mind that Jesus did not undertake his ministry with the evident purpose of starting a new movement either within or outside of Israel. Jesus did not create Christianity. Neither did Paul. They both worked within the framework of, we'll use the term Judaism, even though I have a tension with that. but you don't need to know my attention with that, which was very diverse. It was not static. Oftentimes we think of Judaism and we think of this monolithic movement with one view, one approach, but you think about in the Gospels, aren't there different sects of Judaism? Yeah, so it's not the static movement. So Jesus worked within the framework of Judaism, which was very diverse. It was not static. So he came as a Jew to Jewish people. He accepted the authority of the Old Testament. He conformed to temple practices. He engaged in synagogue worship. And throughout his life, he lived as a Jew. Did Jesus ever break Torah?
No.
Okay. Yeah. He didn't break Torah. He lived as a Jew. Although he occasionally journeyed outside Jewish territory, he insisted that his mission was directed to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Matthew 15:24. You think about Jesus' ministry, and sometimes you almost feel uncomfortable for the way he can treat the Gentile. Sometimes he's very compassionate to them, but other times he's like, I wasn't sent to you. So his ministry was to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Therefore, his mission was to proclaim to Israel that God was now acting to fulfill his promises and to bring Israel to their true destiny. Because Israel was the chosen people of God, the age of fulfillment was offered, not to the world at large, but to the sons of the covenant. So Jesus' ministry, that's how it related to the Jews. We also see both Jesus' followers and his opponents were Jewish. So you see the disciples, this idea of them being the righteous remnant. This concept of Jesus' disciples as the true Israel can be understood against the background of the Old Testament concept of a faithful remnant. Jesus' call of the 12 disciples to share his mission has been widely recognized as a symbolic act setting forth the continuity between the disciples and Israel. Okay, and they are the remnant, not because they have they're no longer Israel, but because they are Israel. Jesus called the 12 disciples to share his mission has been widely recognized as a symbolic act setting forth the continuity between his disciples and Israel, so not discontinuity, that the 12 represent Israel's eschatological role. They sit on the 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Matthew 19:28, Luke 22:30. Also, they were the nucleus of reconstituted true Israel. Recognition that the 12 were meant to constitute the nucleus of the true Israel does not exclude the view that the number 12 also involved a claim upon the entire people, as Jesus' Kahal. 12 as a symbolic number looks both backward and forward, backward to the old Israel and forward to the eschatological Israel. So that's Lad. What I think he's missing there is present. Okay, this idea of the nucleus of a reconstituted Israel is not just past, it is not just future, it is present. That according to Paul, the restoration of Israel had begun. This is Romans 9 through 11. The restoration has begun. Have God's promises failed? No. So they've begun and they are continuing this day. Israel's restoration is taking place. It's in the process of being completed. And so then alongside of Israel's continued restoration, as small as it may seem to us right now, we have the restoration or the inclusion of the Gentiles into the Commonwealth of Israel. And I would argue that if Israel right now presently is not being restored, then there's no way that as the nations we can come in. It's impossible. So we have to hold this tension that Israel's past, future, but also present, God's faithfulness to them. The church is organically related to Israel. So this is really important. So that it is through her, not apart from her, that the kingdom has been extended to the nations. It's really important for us to keep in mind when we think about the significance of Israel for today. that it's through her, not apart from her, that the nations are being included. And this is Walt Kaiser. Okay, so Walt Kaiser says, one of the basic problems we have when thinking through how Israel relates to the church is our starting point. Okay, so we often begin with the church and only then consider Israel from within the church, trying to fit the Jewish people within this framework. So what the church has done, by and large, is we've hijacked Israel's story and said it's our story, and either we replace ourselves with them or we put them on hold. But we are blessed to enter into Israel's story. How dare we hijack it and call it our own? And so Kaiser argues that this fails to reckon with one or more of the following scriptural assertions, and that is this: the church is grafted into Israel, not Israel into the church. And oftentimes we get those two backwards. We want to start with the church and then try to fit Israel in there somewhere. So this is never the question Paul asks. Paul's always asking the questions, how do the nations fit in with Israel? Kaiser also argues, and this might be a point of tension, the new covenant of Jeremiah 31 was made with the house of Judah and the house of Israel, not with the church. And yet this is the covenant that the church wants to point to and say, that's our covenant. Right, Kaiser argues, rather it is not a covenant made with all humanity, but all humanity may be grafted into it. So even though this is Israel's covenant, we get to share in it. This isn't classic dispensationalism, which would say, no, that's Israel's covenant, and there's nothing to do with the Gentiles. Right, we see this promise all the way back with Abraham, that the nations come to share, but we don't come to hijack. We don't come to overtake or replace. And Kaiser says God has had a faithful remnant ever since the beginning of the human race. The church is that portion of the faithful remnant that was called out of the Gentiles since Pentecost, but only to be grafted into the faithful remnant of Israel, thus making up, again, the commonwealth of Israel. So both the church is organically related to Israel. I'll just highlight these last few ones. So Jesus is the messianic shepherd sent by God to gather his people. You see this in the Gospels, and Jesus goes to the Jews, and then you see this carried out by the kingdom people. It's first to the Jew and then to the Gentile. And then expansion or change in the way God's people are constituted, response to Jesus the Messiah. So in the apostolic period, this is expanded to include the nations, which is part of Israel's eschatological hope. Okay, there's plenty of evidence that within certain thoughts of first century Judaism, this idea of the only way for us to get back to where we need to go, the nations need to be brought in. So God's people now make up the commonwealth of Israel, Jews who respond to Jesus Messiah as Jews, Gentiles who respond to Jesus as Gentiles, because God is not just God and King of the Jews, but he is God and King of the nations. So it is the commonwealth of Israel who are his kingdom people. There is distinction between Israel and the church. So distinction between Israel and the church, but not separation. There is oneness in which distinguishable aspects of that oneness are seen. Torah observance for some, rejecting idolatry for others, without implying or necessitating a division of destiny. Okay, so we'll end with this question. How would Jesus' kingdom teaching affect how we think of the church and how we act as the church? What do you think?
Let me think about the institutional nature of the church compared to maybe in the context you were talking about, like the organic free associations. And you really see that in the book of Acts, right? Like the free association, people meet up at each other's houses.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I think about the debt that we owe to the story that we get to join. The fact that we can call ourselves a church because at one time the nations were brought into the Christ movement to the Commonwealth of Israel via the synagogue. Like oftentimes we think of the synagogue as this, that's what those religious Jewish people do. Right? But at one time, that was our identity. Yeah, so I think that what Paul's saying there is that when it comes down to how you are recognized or how you participate in Christ, you don't need to be circumcised. That's not the issue. But I don't think that Paul tables circumcision and uncircumcision in other areas. So it's about trying to figure out what point is Paul making with that statement. So, all right, so 5 minutes, I'll be back.